Today I'm going to show you how to use the American DJ DMX Operator 384. It's 384 channels for up to 12 fixtures. In this room we're using 10 fixtures, and 5 of them are going to be front lighting the stage and 5 of them are going to be rear lighting the stage. So the way I've set it up is I have fixtures 1, 2, 3, 4, and 5 being the front lighting, and 7, 8, 9, 10, and 11 as being the back lighting. I've left these two blank so that if more fixtures are added in the future, it will be easy to program. The DMX lighting system here is on 522 channels, which means that there are 522 different control options for the lights. This board has 384 possible control options. This board will remain on at all times because if the board is turned off, it will cause a flicker to occur. So when you open the case, you'll have, you know, the sound and lighting board, and there'll be other things attached here. But the first thing to note is that there's a little thing here that says blackout. And for the board to work, you have to hit the blackout button. Otherwise, you're going to have nothing happen, because right now if I do anything, nothing's going to happen. So the blackout button is right here. And when you press it, you'll see that flickering light stop. It will stop flickering, so there will be no flicker. And at this point, nothing should be on. Now, I've programmed this board in a specific way, and in this video, I will only share about how to run it under those programs. But below the board, I have like a bag with the three manuals. It's the manual for the front lighting, the manual for the back lighting, as well as the manual for the board. So if you want to program things, I've left scene bank 21 through 30 blank. So that gives you 80 different scenes that you could still program without messing up anything that I've pre-programmed. So feel free to play around with those as well. Everything I show you today will be printed on a sheet, and I'll have it put right in the case so that it's easy to operate. But before I show you the scenes which are for the backlighting, I'm going to show you some basic things about the board as well as how to operate the front lighting, because before you can worry about backlighting subject, it's really important to know how to front light. So for anything to work, you need to click the fixture. So, you know, if I click this one, then the fixture number 1, which is the farthest left front light fixture, will work. Everything is like left to right. So 1 is the farthest left, 2 is the next one over, 3 is the middle one, which is right under the projector. 4 and 5 would therefore be by the window. So if I want to control all of these, I have to do 1, 2, 3, 4, and 5. And I have these fixtures on a 7 channel mode. The fixtures that we're using for our back lighting, I mean our front lighting, are the American DJ 64, PAR 64B, which are LED PAR 64 fixtures with RGBW mixing, which stands for red, green, blue, and white mixing. So the way this is going to work is that channel 1 is going to be your red, channel 2 is going to be your green, channel 3 is going to be your blue, channel 7 is your master. So nothing's going to happen unless you turn on channel 7. So if you want to turn on all three of these, this is going to give you a whitish look. Now channel 4 and 5 have some features. Channel 6 also has features. So these three are features that are programmed into the light, and under normal circumstances, these features will not be used. So don't worry about channel 4, 5, and 6 unless you're doing something that you want to get really fancy on. And what 4, 5, and 6 basically does, 4 does color macros, so it changes the color. It's kind of like it overrides channel 1, 2, and 3. Channel 5, it does strobing. So if you do anything on 5, it's going to strobe. But again, the strobing effects is generally used for backlighting, so don't really worry about it. Channel 6 also has different features, like if you put 6 on to a certain point, it's going to fade the lights at a certain time interval. But again, since this is front lighting, I generally would not worry about touching these because it's really tricky and it's easy to make a mistake on them. So the most important thing to remember is that you're controlling colors with channel 1, 2, and 3. So the red, the green, and the blue. And with channel 7, you're having the master. So if you just have these on, and you don't have 7 on, nothing's going to work. What I like to do is I like to control the colors before and then just fade on 7 nice and slow to bring in that effect. Another thing you can do is you can put on the fade mode to make it where if I put the fade mode onto 3.5, 2 seconds, then no matter how fast I bring that up, the fade will still come slow. The fade can go from 0 to 30 seconds, but if you're using anything with backlighting, I don't recommend using the fade because it kind of messes it up. And that's something that can be explained in the manual, but it's also a little more complicated that I'm not going to cover it here. Now the really nice thing about this board is that you're able to control all the fixtures or one at a time. And so I've angled these five fixtures into different locations. The first one, which is fixture one, is angled on the far wall, on the side wall. Two is also angled on the far wall. So those two are on the far wall. Three is angled right at the center stage. Four and five are angled on the other wall, the wall facing, wall adjacent to the mountain rents room. And the reason I've done it this way is number one, to light both the front and the back of the stage. And number two, to allow for some different color effects. So what I like to do is, you know, I like to have the front lighting pretty white, white or yellow, because it keeps the natural skin tones. But if you want to like readjust channel one or five, it's easy to do something different to make it more exciting. For example, if I want to, right now everything's on full blast. It's a white color. If I want to make the outer colors purple but keep the middles white, I leave this as is and I just deselect those middle three fixtures and I can mix the sides or whatever. And now the sides are going to be purple or blue or whatever I set it to be, but the middle three lights are still going to be white. And what that's going to do is it's going to make the person in the middle of the stage stand out compared to the people in the back. So just remember, whenever you set anything, you have to have the fixtures all selected for it to have an effect. So if I want to just control the first fixture, I'm going to deselect the rest, and then now the first fixture is being controlled. If I want to control two fixtures, I can select those two. And what's important to remember is when I select these two, the ones that I just deselected, three, four, and five, for example, will retain whatever setting I put it on previous to deselecting it. So it's not going to change. It's going to remain the same as it was before. So that's basically the basics of front lighting. One more thing I'd like to add is that generally, to retain the skin tones and not make the person look too ghostly, I generally bring down the greens, the blues. I bring down the blues a little bit. And if I bring it down about 25%, it helps to create a more natural skin tone. And again, a different mix works at different times. But again, when you mix the RGB, it's going to give you a white tone because that's just what it does. However, like regular stage lighting, like what you have in other buildings that are not LED, give you a more yellow tone with the Kelvin temperature in the 5000s. So it's a little bit different. So I just like to keep it a little more neutral like that. Looks good. So that's how you do your front lighting. Now we're going to move on to the back lighting. So the back lighting is fixtures 7, 8, 9, 10, and 11. And the back lighting, rather than being on 7 channels like the front lighting is, it's controlled on 21 channels. So these faders are 8 channels, and you have 4 pages of faders. So page 1, if you click this, it goes to page 2, page 3, and page 4. So you would have to use 3 different pages to control the backlighting manually. And on top of that, the backlighting has all kinds of effects. It has like different movements programmed in. It has different strobing patterns. So if you're doing a show, you don't really want to be manually controlling 21 channels because it gets really tedious. So I've pre-programmed everything into scenes for the backlighting. And the scenes are located here. There's 8 scenes per page. It's actually called per bank. So there are 8 scenes per scene bank, and there are 30 banks of scenes. So the bank number is going to be showing on the third column here, and the scene number is going to show on the second column. The board also has a number of chases. You can have up to 12 chases with over 200 scenes in each chase, but I have not put any chases on the system because it's not necessary for the applications that would be done in the SAC. So don't worry about the first about any of these here. So what's important to note is if you look carefully here, and I'm going to zoom in. So you look right on the panel, If I go up and down with the scenes, it's going to change anywhere from 1 to 30. And I have not used every bank because I wanted to organize it in a way that's easy to understand. So an easy thing to remember is anything from page 1 to 7 is going to be static, which means there will be no movement. And anything from 11 to 17 is going to be having movements. In addition, anything above 21, I'm not going to program anything there because I want to leave it blank for if somebody else wants to program. And notice I said 1 to 7 rather than 1 to 10 because 1 to 7 is going to be a bank for each color, and I'll show you that in a moment. There is red, purple, blue, cyan, or like a blue-green mix. Then there's green, and then there's orange, and there's white. Basically, that's RGB in different mixtures. So purple is red and blue, orange is green and red, and there's, yeah, so different mixtures, and white's its own thing. The exception to the static being 1 to 7 and the movements being on 11 to 17 is the fact that on page 9, which is within the first 10, I have sound active mode put there. So if you go to page 9 and you click scene 1, it's going to put it on sound active mode. And I'll show you this at the end of the video. I'll give a demonstration of what sound active mode works like. Basically, these lights are right behind the speakers that the bass from the speakers will respond with the lights. And do it generally, it will do a pretty good job in guiding the lights and movements. But again, anything from 1 to 7 is static. Anything from 11 to 17 has movements. And the exception is page 9, scene 1. That is going to be sound active mode. An important thing to note is when you click on a scene, it's going to turn on the scene and you'll see it on the stage. If you click it again, it's going to turn it off. If you click on a scene, and then you click on another scene, it's just going to swap the scene. So you don't have to click this one to turn it off. Clicking another scene will override the first scene. It's important to note that you cannot run more than one scene at the same time. I'm going to zoom out now so that you can see the entire board. Realize that at this point, I have channels 1 through 5 selected. But I'm controlling the backlighting with scenes. It doesn't matter. The nice thing is you can be controlling the front lighting while controlling the backlighting at the same time. It's just that whatever fixtures are selected is controlled in this panel. And whatever is being controlled in this panel is separate from that. So the only time you need to select a scene, select a fixture, is when you're controlling it on the controller here. So don't worry about deselecting these or selecting these unless you're programming something. And I don't recommend programming during a live event because it's really risky. So at this point, I'm going to go ahead and re-angle the camera so I can see everything a little better. And I'm going to go through the scenes. So again, for the purpose of operating, you're not going to worry about anything here. Except the blackout button, which is circled in blue. The buttons you need to know about for backlighting is the scene bank, down and up, which I just mentioned, and these different scene options. So at this point, I'm going to show you what each one does. So let's start at page 1, scene bank 1. The first one, so the important thing to note is scene bank 1 and scene bank 11 would be red. Scene bank 2 and scene bank 12 will be scene bank 2 as well as 12, which I'll show in a second, will be a purple. And then 3 will be a blue, 4 will be a blue-green mix, 5 will be a green, 6 will be an orangey-yellow tone, 7 will then be white. So I've done it like that where 1 corresponds with 11, 2 with 12, 3 with 13, 4 with 14, 5 with 15, 6 with 16, and 7 with 17. And what this allows is for the different colors to, you know, be on the same, to be parallel, with movement. So remember, when you go 1 through 7, there's movement. I believe earlier I said it was static, but I actually meant that 1 through 7 are movements, and 11 through 17 is no movement. So yeah, forget what I said earlier about 1 to 7 being static. I said that backwards. So 1 is going to give you a very slow movement. It's going to have the light spinning in a random direction, but very slowly. 2 is going to have a slightly faster movement, but it's still relatively slow, and it works really well for medium-paced songs. 3 is going to have faster movements, and 4 is going to be a strobing effect of the color. So again, whatever page you are on, you can choose the effects in that color. So just keep that in mind, that that's how it works. Now moving on to page 11, we move on to the statics, which means that there's no movement, and actually starts at 11. So with 1, you're going to have the lights facing forward. With 2, you're going to have it facing slightly lower. 3 is even lower, and 4 is the lowest of all. 4 is used for backlighting the second row, which means if you have musicians like the drummer or the people who are behind the front row, 4 would be ideal for that. 3 is kind of like to backlight both everybody on stage. It backlights the people in the back as well as the people in the front. 2 is the one that I recommend the most. It's high enough that it will backlight the head of the front row musician or the speaker, but it will not get in the eyes of the audience. And finally, 1, one is going to be straightforward, which means it will get in the eyes of the people. It's kind of useful for like effects, like you may have it on 2, it's backlighting the speaker, and suddenly you want them to applaud, so you press 1 and they'll clap. And when they're done clapping, you can press that and it will go back down. Unfortunately, it's not very smooth, the movements are fast. And the nice thing to note is that if you're on 2 and you turn up the fade and you go to 1, it's going to go ahead and the movements between the two will be nice and slow. But it's also risky because sometimes the lights will spin because of how they're programmed. But generally, if you're staying within, if you're going between option 1, 2, or 3, it's going to be a nice slow movement. Again, your seconds can go between 0 seconds or 30 seconds. So I may not have explained that super well, but let me do that again. If you put it on a 2 second, 3 second fade, and you click 1, it's going to slowly go from 2 to 1 over 3 seconds. And you click 2, now it's going back down. So that's really a nice time when fade's useful. But just remember, if fade's on, if it affects both the fixtures, which are controlled here, as well as the scenes, which are controlled above. So that's something that's important to realize. So that's about all I have to say about the board. I'm going to turn the camera around and quickly say the different effects one more time. We'll make it where you can see what the lights look like when each of these things are in action. So alrighty, this is what the stage looks like when there's some ambient light in the back. I left that on to make it easier for filming. At this point, none of the spotlights are on, but I have set where the front lighting is ready, set to the color that I wanted. I'm going to go ahead and bait up to channel 7, and it's going to bring on that front lighting. It's pretty white, and as I said earlier, if I want to make the sides colored, I can deselect the middle 3, and I can make the sides like a nice green or a purple or a red or something, and it's easy to control. But for the purpose of this, I'm going to keep all the front lighting on a whitish looking feature. And right now we have the stage pretty messy because we're still finishing up renovations, so excuse the mess. I'm going to go ahead and move on to the backlighting, and I'm going to start with bank 11. Bank 11 through 17, as I said earlier, are going to be static ones. So if I start with number 1, you can see the lights are facing straight at the audience. And notice that it's spun like that. It's nothing to worry about, but when you first activate the lights, it's going to make that complete spin because I programmed it that way. So just be aware of that. So 1 straight at you, 2 goes slightly lower, and as you can see, it's no longer in the eyes of the audience, but it's really nicely backlighting the person on the stage. 3 is even lower, and 4 is lowest of all. And it's hard to see it from this angle, but that's kind of how it looks. So again, I'm going to move on to scene bank 2. I'm now on scene bank 2. I'm on bank 2, scene 4. This is bank 2, scene 3. Bank 2, scene 2. and bank to scene one. Moving up to bank three,
I'm on
bank three, scene one,
bank scene,
bank three, scene two, and so on. And basically, it's just like that. Each color has your four settings. Up to white. And realize that these are 11 to 17, so there's no movement in the lighting. Notice that I have left scenes 5 through 8 blank on each one. Some of them do have things programmed, but it's stuff I was just playing around with, so it's not things I recommend using because it may be out of control. So just keep it to using scenes 1 through 4 on each bank. Also realize that after that, when you go to 18, 19, 20, those are generally blank, but they may have something from the factory, like some settings, so try not to use that unless you're like trying to program something. And I recommend programming things on banks 21 through 30 because that's what I'm leaving. I'm going to leave a blank sheet where you can write in what you program there. All right, moving down to bank number one, these are where there's movements. On bank one, scene one, you're gonna see, you know, the red. This is a slow movement. If I go to bank one, scene two, it's gonna increase the movement speed slightly. If I go to three, it's gonna start moving fast. And if I go to four, it's gonna be strobing. So I'm gonna do that for each color. This is bank two now, and a purple kind of thing, getting it slower, and finally the really slow one. And notice that in between scenes, there are some erratic changes where it like it moves really fast. It's something that the board does that it requires extra programming effects, and I haven't had time to do that, unfortunately. So, yeah. Moving on to three, it's blue. Different styles of strobe. Four. Those are each of the pages. Five again. Go slow, medium, fast, your strobe. Six. It's your yellow. And seven, it's going to be all white. Finally, if you go to page nine and do number one, it's going to be your sound active. And when there's like no sound at all, it's going to give it this weird movement. So I recommend like keeping it on something else, like for example, leaving it either off. Or like, yeah, for example, if you left it off, and then you started your soundtrack, and then you turn on your sound active mode, it really will help things to work a little better. And I only recommend using sound active mode on really heavy songs because if you use it on something light, it's going to get confused and possibly act weird. So I'm going to go ahead and play something, something with a lot of bass. So for example, starting the song, and I'm going to turn it on. Note that there's no bass yet, but once the bass starts, it's going to do more stuff. It moves slightly faster. It's more obvious when the songs are slow, but again, if you have a problem with the movements, you can always black it out and then start again. It will move slowly. And then will have an effect. But again, there's a lot of room for error when you use sound active because any noise from the audience could cause movement. It's really hard to know what's going to happen with sound active, so I just recommend being careful with using sound active mode unless you really want a lot of lights to be dancing around. So that's kind of what I have to say about the light. So if you have any questions, feel free to send me an email or to let me know. But otherwise, that should be everything you need to know about the lights and the sack with blackout. Oh, one last thing. Thank you.
timely, but I'll miss your arms around me. I'd send a postcard to you, dear, 'cause I wish you were here.
Disco ball is just hanging.